like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the world. Sweet the rains do fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where his feet pass. The sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden's all play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of a new day. God's recreation of the new day. Morning is broken. Morning has broken.
We believe. Worship. We use that word a lot, usually when referring to singing, which is a form of worship, because the word worship means to really bow before someone. And so when we sing, we're coming in His presence and lifting Him up. So that is a form of worship. But worship goes way beyond that. It goes to, what do I bow to? For some of us, we really do worship ourselves, because we just surrender to our feelings, our desires, our pleasures, and we go, whatever my body wants, I'm gonna go after that. Others, we worship things like popularity, and we just bow down to people and what they want. Some of us, we just wanna fit into the culture, or we worship the country, or whatever else. But what God says is, look, I wanna be your first allegiance. So worship means you surrender to me. You say, my ways are best, and you gladly come under that type of leadership. And at the core of worship, that's what it's all about.
Good morning and welcome. Thank you for joining us for this service. I hope you're all traveling well, and what I mean is traveling in life, with you in the passenger seat and Jesus doing the driving. Let Him direct your life, to guide and help you. And if you haven't already, give your life over to Him and accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Jesus spoke these words to us, recorded in Matthew chapter 11. And Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Jesus wants to share your burdens and concerns, so let him do that. This morning, Pastor Steve will continue the series on the book of Jeremiah, so we look forward to that. And now, will you join me in prayer? So let us pray. Let us come before God in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for this opportunity to be part of this service where we can worship you and give thanks for all you have done. Even though we are not together in the one building, we are one in the Lord Jesus, who gave us life that we might have life to the full, a life of fellowship with our Creator, the Almighty God. For those of our church family who are ill at this time, Lord, bring healing to them. Strengthen them physically and spiritually. I pray for those in our church and throughout the community who are struggling with the situation we are in because of the coronavirus. People who are anxious, those who have lost income, those who feel separated from others, and the distress that that brings. I pray that your presence, your healing power would be given to them to encourage and bring healing in every way. I pray for the people in government, state and federal, that they would seek wisdom from you in decisions that have to be made. Bless Pastor Steve and his family, our elders and deacons, Joe and Daniel. Give them wisdom and guidance as they also make decisions in the coming weeks. Bless them and all your people at IBC with a strong bond to you. Help us to be in prayer with you, to be encouraged by your word in the Bible, and speak through Steve this morning as he brings that word. And pray that it would speak to each one of us. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stories of the Bible. Jesus appears to Thomas. This is Jesus.
Heyo!
Who is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. While Jesus was on earth, he taught everyone about God's love and healed people from their sickness. He did many miracles like calming storms and even raised people from the dead.
Wahoo!
But some people did not like what Jesus was doing. And they put him to death. He died on a cross and was buried in a tomb. For 3 days, Jesus' body laid in that tomb, and it seemed that there was no hope. But very early on Sunday morning, the woman who cared for Jesus went to go visit his body, found that his tomb was empty, and that he was no longer there. For he was risen. He was alive.
Woohoo!
What? Heyo!
Jesus appeared to his disciples to show them that he was alive. One of the 12 disciples, Thomas, was not with the others when Jesus came.
Hey, Thomas!
Later, the disciples told Thomas, "We have seen the Lord." But Thomas said, "I won't believe it unless I see the nail wounds in his hands, put my fingers into them, and place my hand into the wound in his side." 8 days later, the disciples were together again, and this time Thomas was with them. The doors were locked, but suddenly, as before, Jesus was standing among them.
Oh, hey guys.
"Peace be with you," he said. Then Jesus said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and look at my hands. Put your hand into the wound in my side. Don't be faithless any longer. Believe." Thomas said, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, you believe because you have seen me. Blessed are those who believe without seeing me.
Over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing of when your love came down. I could sing of your love forever. 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 Over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing of when your love came down. I could sing of your love forever. 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 Oh, I feel like dancing. It's foolishness, I know, but when the world has seen the light, they will dance with joy like we're dancing now. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your sea, your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free.
Good morning. Let's read God's word together from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 27 and 28, starting at verse 1 in chapter 27. Early in the reign of Zedekiah, son of Josiah, king of Judah, this word came to Jeremiah from the Lord. This is what the Lord said to me: make a yoke out of straps and crossbars and put it on your neck. Then send word to the kings of Edom, Moab, Ammon, Tyre, and Sidon through the envoys who have come to Jerusalem to Zedekiah, king of Judah. Give them a message for their masters and say, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Tell this to your masters: with my great power and outstretched arm, I made the earth and its people and the animals that are on it, and I give it to anyone I please. Now I will give all your countries into the hands of my servant Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. I will make even the wild animals subject to him. All nations will serve him, and his son and his grandson, until the time for his land comes. Then many nations and great kings will subjugate him. I gave the same message to Zedekiah, king of Judah. Do not listen to the words of the prophets who say to you, you will not serve the king of Babylon, for they are prophesying lies to you. I have not sent them, declares the Lord. They are prophesying lies in my name. Therefore, I will banish you, and you will perish, both you and the prophets who prophesy to you. Chapter 28, verse 1. In the fifth month of that same year, the prophet Hananiah, son of Azor, who was from Gibeon, said to me in the house of the Lord, in the presence of the priests and all the people, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. I will break the yoke of the king of Babylon. Within 2 years, I will bring back to this place all the articles of the Lord's house that Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, removed from here and took to Babylon. I will also bring back to this place Jehoiachin, son of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, and all the other exiles from Judah who went to Babylon, declares the Lord. For I will break the yoke of the king of Babylon. Then the prophet Jeremiah replied to the prophet Hananiah before the priests and all the people who were standing in the house of the Lord. He said, Amen, may the Lord do so. May the Lord fulfill the words you have prophesied by bringing the articles of the Lord's house and all the exiles back to this place from Babylon. Nevertheless, listen to what I have to say in your hearing and in the hearing of all the people. From early times, the prophets who preceded you and me have prophesied war, disaster, and plague against many countries and great kingdoms. But the prophet who prophesies peace will be recognized as one truly sent by the Lord, only if his prediction comes true. Then the prophet Hananiah took the yoke off the neck of the prophet Jeremiah and broke it. And he said before all the people, This is what the Lord says, in the same way I will break the yoke of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, off the neck of all the nations within 2 years. Then the prophet Jeremiah said to Hananiah the prophet, Listen, Hananiah, the Lord has not sent you, yet you have persuaded this nation to trust in lies. Therefore, this is what the Lord says, I am about to remove you from the face of the earth. This very year you are going to die, because you have preached rebellion against the Lord. In the 7th month of that same year, Hananiah the prophet died.
Like millions of people in America and around the world, Jeremiah Johnson stayed up late on November 3rd, 2020. From the TV screen in his living room, he watched as Donald Trump's winning margin waned and he sat stunned in disbelief. Many that Johnson knew had assumed that the former president would win re-election. And Johnson was among Christian leaders in the US who had put God's word behind it and had prophesied that Donald Trump would win the 2020 election. The next morning, as the country woke up to the news that Joe Biden was in the lead, Johnson sent out a prophetic warning to his mailing list, saying that he and a chorus of mature and tested prophets were in agreement. Trump had won. This is what he said. Either a lying spirit has filled the mouths of numerous trusted prophetic voices in America, or Donald J. Trump really has won the presidency, and we are witnessing a diabolical and evil plan unfold to steal the election. I believe with all my heart that the latter is true. However, today, Johnson cringes when he thinks back to that message. Unlike those who continued to contest the result and insist that Trump won, by February 2021, Jeremiah Johnson had changed course. Today, he barely recognises the person who wrote that email last year, and neither does his wife or his staff or his close friends. Instead, he says God graciously used the messy fallout to begin a catalytic and dramatic shift in his life. He later said, I was as entrenched as anyone was. I tell people I feel like I've been rescued. I feel the kindness of God. I feel his discipline. I've cried so many tears just thanking the Lord for the wake-up call. Troubled times are often uncertain times, and our world is certainly experiencing this at the moment, isn't it? I mean, besides pandemic uncertainty, who'd have thought that we'd be seeing riots in Australian cities and an earthquake in Melbourne? And in the midst of all of this, it's easy to be drawn to those who not only offer certainty, but say what it is that we want to hear. And what most of us want to hear is that it's going to be okay, that everything's going to work out in our favour. And so in this account that we had read to us today from Jeremiah's life, if where people are given a choice between Jeremiah's message of disaster and Hananiah's message of hope, most people are going to go with the prophet Hananiah. Have a listen to this. Chapter 28, verse 2 to 4. The prophet Hananiah, son of Azur, who was from Gibeon, said to me in the house of the Lord, in the presence of the priests and all the people, "This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. I will break the yoke of the king of Babylon. Within 2 years I will bring back to this place all the articles of the Lord's house that Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, removed from here and took to Babylon. I will also bring back to this place Jehoiakim, son of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, and all the other exiles from Judah who went to Babylon, declares the Lord, for I will break the yoke of the king of Babylon." Now, if we just read those verses, it'd be tempting to see Hananiah as the true prophet. He seems more full of faith than fear. You know, in the original Hebrew of this prophet, there's no hint that Hananiah is a false prophet. He has the same title, he uses the same language as Jeremiah, and he puts on a good show. Things are much more enjoyable when Hananiah is around. But that's part of the problem. Hananiah's job was to make things more enjoyable. That's why the king had chosen him to be in court. But that's not how Old Testament prophets were rightly appointed. You didn't get to choose to be a prophet, nor did another person choose you. You didn't get to say what you wanted to say. You did it because God told you to do it, and God told you what to say. God didn't call prophets to tell people what they already thought and wanted to hear. The prophet's job was to say things that people weren't hearing. And so Jeremiah, as he often expresses to God himself, says that true prophets regularly had to say things that they didn't want to say. It was their job to call people back to the original covenant while proclaiming the coming of the new covenant. But since Jesus, we now live under the new covenant, the new arrangement between God and human beings. And that's why I don't think that the role of prophet exists the same today as it did in the Old Testament. Prophets are rarely involved in predictions in the New Testament, but what they are doing is making God's word clear. What they're doing is helping people to apply God's word accurately, which is why Paul tells the Corinthians to desire the gift of prophecy more than the gift of tongues. In other words, to desire clarity over confusion. The New Testament role of prophecy is a gift from the Holy Spirit for clarifying and sharpening the word of God. We don't need a new word. We have the definitive word already. Hebrews chapter 1 verse 3, "In the past God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days he has spoken to us by his Son." And of course, as John wrote in his Gospel in chapter 1, "The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son. And the divine messenger has been given to us." John 14 verse 26, Jesus says, "But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you." In fact, most of what the Old Testament prophets did was forthtelling, not foretelling. And this is the best description of New Testament prophecy today: telling forth the often hard things to hear and restating the true biblically founded things that give us encouragement and hope and clarity when we need it. Part of the dysfunction of the court prophets of Hananiah's day was their presence in an echo chamber, a place where we just hear other people's ideas and opinions that are the same as ours. In February 2021, Lauren Sanford joined Jeremiah Johnson in recognizing that he'd been part of the Trump echo chamber of prophets. This so-called prophet apologized for his prediction in God's name. He implied that a reason for his false prediction was that he listened to his own desire over God's voice. Another element of how I got it wrong was this: the tendency we have to hear what we want to hear. Strong desire and strong opinions play a huge role in distorting the words we believe we hear, if we allow that to happen. So, if we return to Hananiah and we just scratch the surface a little bit, what do we see behind his message? Basically, he's saying, you can have whatever you want. You want peace? So do I. Let's believe in peace. I believe that everything is going to work out fine. Now, just as God described through Jeremiah in Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 13 to 14, this is what the prophets were like back in those times. Most of them. Prophets and priests alike all practice deceit. They dress the wound of my people as though it were not serious. Peace, peace, they say, when there is no peace. You know, I can't help but hear the echoes of these words in the common gospel of the 21st century. Believe in yourself and you can have whatever you want. Follow your heart. Speak and think positive thoughts out into the universe and it'll come back to you. Have you heard something like that? I remember picking up a book in the 1990s by a prominent Australian pastor who said, if you want that house, you go and sit outside that house and you believe God for it until you get it. You want that car or that job, you believe that God will give it to you. It's the same thing, really, as believing yourself with a bit of God thrown in. It validates our desires, our lifestyles, and the best thing is it doesn't ask us to change a thing. But what if the problem is that we do need to change? What do we do when we realize that our thoughts, our impulses, and our heart, our desires, aren't necessarily trustworthy? What if following our heart gets us into trouble? Chapter 17, verse 9 of Jeremiah, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately sick. Who can understand it? When Hananiah counters Jeremiah's message of God's disruption, Jeremiah gives a gracious reply. Have a listen to chapter 28, verse 5 through 6. Then the prophet Jeremiah replied to the prophet Hananiah before the priests and all the people who were standing in the house of the Lord. He said, Amen. In other words, let it be so. May the Lord do so. May the Lord fulfill the words you have prophesied by bringing the articles of the Lord's house and all the exiles back to this place from Babylon. And you know, this kind of approach is really important when we're speaking to others, isn't it? Especially now when opinions and different people's perspectives are so strong. To be able to say, yeah, I hear where you're coming from. I wish we weren't in this position. And my hope is for things to be healed and to be restored as well. Yet however much Jeremiah wishes the same outcome as Hananiah, he knows that the best is not going to come from what he or anyone else wants. It's going to come from what God wants. Chapter 28, verse 7 through 9. Nevertheless, listen to what I have to say in your hearing and the hearing of all the people. From early times, the prophets who preceded you and me have prophesied war, disaster, and plague against many countries and great kingdoms. But the prophet who prophesies peace will be recognized as the one truly sent by the Lord only if his prediction comes true. That is a powerful statement, isn't it? It actually comes from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 18, verse 2, where Moses said, if a prophet proclaims in the name of the Lord, does not take place or come true, that is a message the Lord has not spoken. That prophet has spoken presumptuously, so do not be alarmed. And you know, it should give every one of us reason to pause. Now, you and I might not be making many prophetic predictions, but we can easily make bold statements on God's behalf. You shouldn't do this, or you shouldn't do that. You should think this or think that. You should act like this or act like that. We must be very careful in claiming what is right and what is wrong, what is certain and what is uncertain, what we think should and shouldn't be. The best we can say is, from what I can tell, God is saying this. And then have very good reasons, biblically informed reasons, for thinking that way. Jesus' brother James cautions against claiming we have any kind of mastery over our own future, let alone anyone else's. James chapter 4, verse 15 to 16, he says, instead you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogant schemes, all such boasting is evil. In Jeremiah's case, he experiences a nasty reply from Hananiah. And really, this is no surprise, because if Hananiah believes in himself, then who is Jeremiah to tell him otherwise? Chapter 28, verse 10 through 11. Then the prophet Hananiah took the yoke off the neck of the prophet Jeremiah and broke it. And he said before all the people, this is what the Lord says. In the same way, I will break the yoke of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, off the neck of all the nations within 2 years. At this, the prophet Jeremiah went on his way. You know, the guy I mentioned earlier in this sermon, Jeremiah Johnson, experienced the same kind of backlash in February 2021 when he publicly apologized for making this wrong prophecy. Because he was basically saying, if you still believe in my prophecy, you're wrong. He was entirely unprepared, though, for the vitriol that he received in response to his apology. He writes on his Facebook page 3 days later, Over the last 72 hours, I have received multiple death threats and thousands upon thousands of emails from Christians saying the nastiest and most vulgar things I have ever heard toward my family and ministry. I have been labelled a coward, sellout, a traitor to the Holy Spirit, and cussed out at least 500 times. We have lost ministry partners every hour and counting. He shared his heartache at the barrage of continued conspiracy theories sent his way in pure hatred. And I think it's worth sharing his apology with you. He said, "First, I would like to repent for inaccurately prophesying that Donald Trump would win a second term as the President of the United States. I refuse to blame the saints and say it didn't come to pass because they didn't pray enough, nor will I proclaim Donald Trump actually did win, so I was right, but now it's been stolen from him. I want to go on record. I was wrong. I am deeply sorry and I ask for your forgiveness. I specifically want to apologize to any believer in whom I have now caused potential doubt concerning the voice of God and his ability to speak to his people. As a human being, I missed what God was saying. However, rest assured, God himself is not a liar, and his written word should always be the foundation and source of our lives as Christians." Now, that is the way to respond to a mistake, with grace and humility and repentance. And why could he do that? Because when your faith is in God and not in yourself, your world won't fall apart when you admit that you got it wrong. Confessing mistakes is actually the first step to putting things back together the right way. If you back yourself, though, when you discover that you're wrong and you double down, you're just digging a bigger hole for yourself. But the great thing is this. God loves to pull people out of holes. As you read through the Bible, you see he did it for Joseph, he did it for Daniel, he did it for Jeremiah later on, and he does it for David, as David writes in Psalm 40. "He lifted me out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and mire." But it's important to see just how God does so. Have you ever seen a rescue helicopter rescuing someone from the city or from the sea or from a gully? What they do is they lower a harness down and then they say, "Strap yourself in." Now, I just want to make a quick aside here. You know, this doesn't just apply when we get it wrong, but also when life goes wrong. We can find ourselves in a big hole just because of the tough times that we live in. You may have lost some or all work at the moment. You might be under some financial stress. There might be family tensions, pandemic fatigue, global anxiety, lockdown fever, or some kind of illness or accident that's taken place. You might be in a spiritual desert, a psychological wasteland, or an emotional hurricane, or even just feel like you're in a vacuum. Whether what you're feeling has a label, whether it's depression or anxiety or burnout, or whether it's unnamed, whether you find yourself in a hole, or whether you find yourself in a desert, look for help, and especially look up. Psalm chapter 42, verse 5 says, "Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Saviour and my God." Don't simply believe in yourself alone. Believe in God. And then, as you listen for him, believe God. Do what he says. Put yourself into the harness and trust him. So, Jeremiah turns up with this harness, a wooden yoke that would have been used on donkeys or oxen. No wonder people responded badly to this message. I mean, who wants to wear a yoke? I can imagine one of our elders, Ron, saying, "You must be yoking." But let's first ask, why is Jeremiah himself willing to wear this yoke? Because he's okay with wearing a yoke that God has given. He believes in God, and as a result, he's happy to be directed by God. Because Jeremiah knows that when we find ourselves in tough times, we need the true words of God, not just sugary platitudes or fairy floss philosophy. So after being smashed by Hananiah, Jeremiah returns after hearing from God, this time with a message of an iron yoke. You see, wooden yokes were for domesticated animals, for animals that were part of the household, but iron yokes were for prisoners and wild animals. From verse 12 of chapter 28, after the prophet Hananiah had broken the yoke off the neck of the prophet Jeremiah, the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah, "Go and tell Hananiah, this is what the Lord says. You have broken a wooden yoke, but in its place you will get a yoke of iron. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. I will put an iron yoke on the necks of all those nations to make them serve Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, and they will serve him. I will even give him control over the wild animals." Then the prophet Jeremiah said to Hananiah, the prophet, "Listen, Hananiah, the Lord has not sent you, yet you have persuaded this nation to trust in lies. Therefore, this is what the Lord says. I am about to remove you from the face of the earth. This very year you are going to die because you have preached rebellion against the Lord." In the seventh month of that year, Hananiah the prophet died. Now, there's one more important thing to notice before we close. The yoke Jeremiah would have used would probably not have been a prison yoke. It would have been a livestock yoke, a long crossbeam with two sets of leather straps, one for each animal. And between those two straps, there would have been this long beam that ran back to the plough. So imagine this kind of thing hanging around Jeremiah's neck as he tried to sort of drag it around and speak to all of these leaders in chapter 27 and 28. Ultimately, the yoke spoke of submission to God through submission to the invading army of King Nebuchadnezzar. Now, think of an image you may also have seen about another man 600 years later dragging a beam, a couple of beams of wood shaped like a T, as a sign of his submission to God. But this time, his submission to God came through a Roman governor. This time, instead of the people being judged, bearing the consequences of their own wrongdoing, it is the prophet himself who bears the consequences of their sin, and the sin and the wrong of the whole world. Jesus is exiled from the land of the living. But as we'll see in the next chapter of Jeremiah next week, the exiles come back, and so too with Jesus. He comes back, but this time he has left the door wide open. Anyone who follows him in the same way can find the certainty and hope of life that he has. And what is that way? Well, Jesus says, it's stop believing in yourself and believe in me. Luke chapter 9, verse 23 to 25. Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world and yet lose or forfeit their very self? Submit yourself to me, Jesus says. Now, that word can seem offensive today, but only because we misunderstand it. Jesus is not talking about yoking ourselves to hard labour so that God can, you know, get his farming done, have something for himself. What God is talking about is something for our own benefit. Have a look at Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, where Jesus says, "Come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke on you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Because let's face it, it's a lot of pressure to be under, to have to believe in yourself, to save yourself, to rescue yourself. And the closer you get to death, the older you get, or the more stressed in life you become, the more you realize you don't have what it takes. But here's the thing. We were never designed as creatures to survive on our own. Of course, when it comes to a yoke, we might think of this kind of yoke. And we think of how a yoke actually produces a sense of security for a domesticated animal, because the yoke represents a place where we're provided for, a place where our needs are met, a place where we have the care that we need. And so it is that when it comes to us thinking about the yoke that Jesus offers us, it's not really about the work. It's not about the demands. It's not about being taken from being a wild animal to being a domesticated animal. It's about the fact that we as human beings were created to be in relationship with God, just like my dog survives much better in this world when it's in relationship with me and my family. And so it is that when we think of the yoke which Jesus is offering us, it's not a burdensome yoke, it's a light yoke. It fits well, it fits right and properly, because when we're yoked to Jesus, we're in the place of security where he meets every one of our needs. The only way we thrive is when we're joined with our Creator, where Jesus does all of the heavy lifting for us. But even more than that, he offers to train us in how to create a fulfilled and fruitful life. There's no more blindly stumbling along, but instead it's following his lead, being joined to him, having him share the load. You can imagine, can't you? If you tried to lug a heavy two-sided yoke over the ground, sweating and straining, and when you get to the edge of the field, you look back, you'd see a complete mess all over the place. But with someone in the yoke who knows what they're doing, you'll be able to look back and see, oh, that's good. That's why we pulled harder there. That's why we changed direction. That's why we zigged when I thought we should have zagged. The gospel is not believe in yourself. It's believe in Jesus. Submit to him. Attach yourself to him. And learn to live in step with him. That's when we find ourselves in a place of peace and fruitfulness, in the life that we were made to live. One that is just like that of Jesus. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you call us to a life where we are so joined to you that you are the one who does the heavy lifting. You are the one who guides us and leads us. You are the one who teaches us so that our life may be fruitful and we may thrive and we may see the people around us thrive. Because it's only when God leads that God's world comes about. We thank you, Lord, that your world is a world where we are loved and we get to love each other to the fullest extent possible, just like Jesus. Father, we thank you for your gift to us by giving us a yoke that we may be joined to Jesus. Lord, help us to take up this yoke or this cross, submit to you, because we need you, Lord, and we will put our faith and trust in you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, thank you for joining us again this morning. It's been good to be part of this service and to meet in this way. I'd like to close with these words from the book of Numbers, and it's a blessing for each one of us. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen.
To worship you, to tell you we're